So hi everyone, welcome to an extra special ThinkHouse Foundations webinar discussing COP28. Some of you may recognise me as the co-chair of ThinkHouse Foundations, but I'm also a senior associate in the environment team in London. I'm pleased to be joined today by two of my Gowling colleagues, Isabella Parks from the International Projects and Infrastructure team in Dubai, and Graham Reeder from the environment team in Toronto. I'm also joined today by Maram Salah al-Din, an environmental attorney based in the Washington DC office of law firm Clark Hill. During the webinar, please feel free to submit any questions you may have for our panelists on the Q&A function, and we'll aim to get through as many as possible either during the webinar or at the end. If we're unable to get through all of them, we'll happily follow up with you after the webinar. So COP28 is the 28th annual meeting of the parties to the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change. Every year, delegates from the nations who are parties to the convention meet to discuss progress on tackling climate change and ambitions for the future, including what needs to be done to limit global warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels by the end of the century. 2 years ago, global leaders descended on the UK, COP26 in Glasgow, and last year's COP27 was hosted by Sharm el-Sheikh in Egypt. Bella, you're based in Dubai and you've been attending COP in the past week. So tell us a bit about what it's been like and what the buzz in Dubai is right now.
Hello, hello to everyone listening. First of all, I just want to thank you, Nick, for having me here on the panel. Being at COP this week has been very, very busy. It's been electric, honestly. It's been a real experience. And I'm glad I'm here to talk about it with you all today. So day one at COP, I wasn't there personally, as it was. Only the blue zone, so political parties talking about the strong messaging coming from Dr. Sultan al-Jaber and what we saw coming out of COP27 in Egypt. There was big talk of the loss and damage fund and how that's going to be addressed in the following days. And then day two, we saw all the political leaders arrive for the conference of parties. We saw the UAE come in and say that they've invested already $100 billion in renewable energy. And they're saying that they're going to invest another $130 billion in the next 7 years. We also saw King Charles' speech, which was a massive call for collaboration, for ambition and for humanity to come together and create some real change. We also saw the president of Brazil, who they'll be hosting COP30. There was a really passionate speech calling for more implementation and basically moving past drafting of treaties. I think what I've really noticed is everyone's getting very frustrated with all of these treaties being drafted and, you know, all of these agreements being made and declarations, but not really much action yet, considering, you know, we're now at the 28th COP. So there's been a real drive for action. Day three there was a lot on fossil fuels and the removal of, or the reduction of fossil fuels. There was also a massive push for renewable energy. I know 118 countries signed a declaration. I think now that it's gone from 118 to, I think, almost 130 countries. I could be wrong. It could be even more than that now, to double the global average of renewable energy projects going on in the world. And the COP presidency also announced another $1 billion in financing commitments for climate and health. There was also further calls for action in draft texts of the global stocktake. For Indigenous persons and women and the youth also to put their thoughts forward. And then day four was my first day when the Green Zone opened. I was very, very excited to get there and see what was going on. And the first round of the negotiations of the global stocktake were concluded on day four. Obviously, we've seen over the last few days that negotiations keep continuing, so we can't say that, you know, that they've come to a close just yet. I went to a very interesting fireside chat on the importance of ensuring that climate finance is distributed equitably for those that most need it. So, you know, not just the global north, but, you know, countries in the global south that really need that investment to make sure that they are meeting their climate targets. Day five, I saw a lot of collaboration in terms of meaningful change. We need to, you know, working together, sharing experiences, and making sure that someone who's gone through a project or like a renewable energy project is not keeping those experiences to themselves. So I attended a really interesting talk about how we need to be using each other's experiences and be building on those experiences, as there's a lot of renewable energy projects and climate projects going on in the African continent that are just kept in the pipeline, because one of the reasons is that the financial institutions and the developers aren't communicating well enough. So there's a massive mystery over project finance, and so that needs demystifying, and people need educating on how to get these projects into fruition. Also a massive drive for the phasing out of fossil fuels. We're only 7 years away from the deadline for the Paris Agreement of 2030. So we need to use the science behind the Paris Agreement and the reasons for reducing fossil fuels and making sure that people know these need to be shared more widely. In the 4 days of the, so from day five, COP28 has mobilized over 57 billion US dollars across the entire climate agenda, which was incredible to witness. We also saw Kenya's President Ruto committing to 1 trillion dirhams, which divided by three, it's probably just over 300,000 US dollars towards their climate agenda. Day six, there was about one of the themes was indigenous people. So we saw a lot of indigenous communities coming together and presenting their views and their half of their of the conversation. And then day seven yesterday, we saw the political negotiations come to a close. Obviously we know that they're still going on at the moment, but the party celebrated progress on the loss and damage fund, including operationalizing the fund and agreeing a host for the Santiago Network, which provides technical knowledge and support to developing countries. I think a lot of the good news has been outweighed by frustration, to be honest, because there's been a lot of talk and a lot of agreements, but still not a lot of action. And there's been a complete failure of parties to reach any agreement on transparency, and a pillar of the Paris Agreement was retaining transparency and creating transparency between everyone. There also needs to be a building of trust between competitors in the market. But the buzz in Dubai has been, honestly, it's been electric. Everyone's been talking about it. There's all the billboards up down the roads, probably very much on purpose, all about renewable energy projects, all about how companies are being sustainable, even fashion companies, how they're reducing their carbon emissions. It's been amazing. It's been really, really good. Today, I wasn't at the site today, but I'll be back there tomorrow. So I haven't done my LinkedIn post yet, but it's coming.
Thanks, Bella. That's a great overview of what's been going on. It's just in the first week. It sounds very busy, and I've been following your LinkedIn posts with great interest. The appointment of Dubai as host of COP28 has been quite controversial in some circles, and especially the appointment of Dr. Sultan bin Ahmed Al Jaber, head of the Abu Dhabi National Oil Company, as president of COP28. But is Dubai's reputation, as a big bad polluter, fair? Is there another side to this argument?
100%. Obviously, I'm very biased. I've lived in Dubai for the last 24 years, so I actually grew up here. And I've seen incredible change and incredible development. And yes, that's come with its costs. But also there's a lot of sustainability in Dubai and in within the UAE that not a lot of people know. So for example, Burj Khalifa, I think everyone knows the Burj Khalifa, tallest building in the world. From the top 10 landmarks in the world, Burj Khalifa is actually the cheapest to light. There's also solar panels all over Burj Khalifa along the bottom sections, because as you get closer up to the top, there's not enough surface area. But there's a total of 378 solar panels on Burj Khalifa, which are used to heat more than 140,000 litres of water every 7 hours. And also there's been loads of laws passed where, for example, in 2015, there was a law that was passed that in the Emirate of Dubai, any new building has to have 75% of their water usage heated by solar powered water heaters. We've got two of the largest solar farms here in the UAE. We've got Noor Abu Dhabi solar plant, which is the world's largest single site power plant, and provides 90,000 homes with 1.17 gigawatts of power. We've also got Mohammed bin Rashid Al Maktoum Solar Park in the UAE, which is the largest in the world, and the current capacity is 1.63 gigawatts of power, planning to grow to 5 gigawatts by 2030. But it's all part of the UAE's 2050 plan to reduce their emissions and produce 75% of Dubai's energy requirements from clean and renewable sources. So there's a lot of hidden, it's all on Google, but a lot of people don't know. And for Dr. Sultan Al Jaber, he may be, you know, the CEO of ADNOC, he's also the CEO of Masdar, which is one of the sustainable cities in Abu Dhabi. And there's been a lot of talk on always using it for oil deals. And ADNOC don't need COP28 to, you know, get to push their agenda. You know, they can sell enough oil without COP28. So I think there's been a real unfair view, from especially Western countries, on his presidency of COP28. But that's only obviously my personal view. But I think, you know, you need the leaders of these oil companies to be part of the change and leading the change to make it worthwhile and make long-lasting change. Otherwise, you're not going to see it. You need to change mindsets through grassroots, but you can only create change through, like, political change through the leaders.
I absolutely agree. Thanks, Bella. And we're very lucky on this panel because, Graham, in your previous career, you were involved in the negotiations behind the scenes at COP, and you've attended four COPs to date. Can you tell us a bit about what goes on behind all the razzmatazz and the leader speeches that we see on the news, and what don't we see? What don't we see on the TV and in the newspapers?
Sure. So yeah, for a bit of background, about a decade ago now, which is, it's hard to believe, I was attending COPs in support of a few developing country delegations and doing negotiation support. There's a couple things that I think from the news, we've been, certainly I've noticed, we've been bombarded with announcements from COP28, which is some of them really excellent announcements and great news. A lot of them about bilateral or even multilateral agreements that are actually aren't related to the UNFCCC, right? They aren't related to the negotiating text on the table. And so that's an interesting thing, right? COPs have become kind of the launch pad for bilateral or multilateral agreements, or even unilateral agreements, negotiations, announcements. It's where the world comes to make their announcements about climate targets. It is also a space of international legal negotiation, right? So this first week has been the space where, and to be candid as well, the whole year running, negotiations are happening. They don't just happen in a 2-week period at the end of November. We wouldn't get very far with just that. But parties are meeting throughout the year, usually in Bonn, Germany, where the Secretariat is hosted. and trying to make progress on draft text and pieces of agreement and figuring out what's even on the agenda at COP. And then this whole first week has been a series of working groups on a variety of different topics where parties are putting forward their proposed language. So we've got now at the end of the first week, we've got draft texts on a whole slew of different topics. They're typically called chair's texts that get forwarded to the plenary. And the plenary is all parties that have to come to agreement on final text. So the second week, we're kind of pivoting to the negotiation element, right? Everyone's put what they want on the table, but now in order to come to agreement, you've got to do some horse trading. You've got to say, well, we'll lose that request if you can move on this. So on most topics, we have draft text, and that's good news. So the chair of COP at the end of the week said, you know, we're making good progress on these. His focus is going to be on high-level talks, getting key players in the room with one another to hammer out the real sticking points. And it seems like the real sticking points are not particularly surprising, but the global stock take is the big one. It's the kind of big deadline for this COP. The maybe some more surprising one is that there hasn't been any progress really on the global adaptation goal, and we can talk about more later. But there's no agreed text to work from yet. So that's a bad sign at this stage of the negotiations for that topic. And so we'll have to see what happens coming from there.
Thanks, Graham. And Ben, I said earlier that there's still a lot of frustration, that there is a lot of talk, but no action. And Greta Thunberg last week before the start said that COP is a load of blah, blah, blah. Is she right? Do you think the public are losing interest and faith in COP?
I think yes and no. I think it's absolutely a fair criticism that there is a lot of talk at COPs, and COPs are maybe not where ambition for climate action happens, right? Ambition for climate action happens at home in every home country. COPs are where you can set the standard of where the international community is and hopefully push it forward a little bit. But it's not going to be the place where climate change is solved. It is, however, I think a lot of people, often I think there are a few good examples I'm happy to share that of institutions or programs that have been agreed to at COPs past that have been really significant in terms of climate change that couldn't just be domestic, right? That one country couldn't do on their own. So anyone who works in forestry will know about REDD+, which is the reduction of emissions through deforestation and forest degradation. REDD+ is essentially a market framework where developing countries that have large forest stocks can get credit for avoiding deforestation and preventing deforestation, and they in turn get finance from developed countries who are looking for emissions reductions credit. They get finance to help preserve those forests. So it's an estimated about 11 billion tons of CO2 equivalent have been avoided through REDD in the last 15 years or so. So that's a pretty significant thing that can't exist without international cooperation. One country can't implement that. And that was born out of climate negotiations. The Clean Development Mechanism was a product of the Kyoto Protocol, and that was where developed countries, particularly Kyoto Protocol members, developed countries, so Canada, the EU, Japan, New Zealand, Australia, could get credits for their emissions reductions by funding emissions reduction projects in the developing world, because they could get way better bang for their buck and reduce emissions faster by helping sustainable development in the global south than they could by reducing emissions at home, which they still had to do under the Kyoto Protocol. But this was a funding market mechanism that helped facilitate that. Again, this that would not exist without the UNFCCC. So while it's fair to say, absolutely fair to say that the COP process is not keeping pace with the scale of climate change as a crisis, it's not fair to say that it accomplishes nothing. It certainly, we would be in a much worse place without it, arguably.
That's a fair point. And I think one of the major accomplishments of COP27 last year was establishment of a loss and damage fund, which you both touched upon. And this will be a fund which will pay out to nations affected by climate change. And while there's still a lot to be resolved, including the eligibility for payouts and when these payouts will start, the president of COP28 was keen to get the ball rolling from day one, of COP28, and urged nations to start pledging to this fund. The UAE has pledged $100 million to the fund. The UK has pledged $47 million. Canada has pledged approximately $12.5 million, and the US has pledged $17.5 million. Maram, should we have expected more from the US, or are John Kerry's hands tied in this respect?
Thanks, Nick. Yeah, it's always the question, right, with the US when it comes to these agreements. And for what it's worth, I was actually just reading this morning that some outlets are reporting actually an additional $7 million to other mechanisms related to the legal fund. I haven't gotten confirmation of that. But even if we split the difference and say about $20 million from the US, you'll certainly get answers on both ends of the spectrum, right? So a lot of pressure from the international community, and even back home here from a lot of environmental advocates and groups pushing for the US to do more and pay more as one of the top two emitters along with China, right, in the world. And we all know that conversation's been going on a long time. But to answer your other part of your question, as far as John Kerry's hands being tied, there are some limitations. And going back to what Graham was talking about, some of the conversations and pre-planning and efforts that are going on domestically, a lot of countries, there's some of those challenges that the U.S. Is going through. Looking at Congress, we've got a divide, right, in the upper house and the lower house. We've got Senate with a Democratic majority, House of Representatives with a Republican majority. So there's definitely a push and pull there as far as what the U.S. Congress is able to do. But I also think it's a little bit unfair, because when we look at just that one fund, maybe the number is not as high as we would like, but the amount of investment that the U.S. government has been putting into climate change efforts, both domestically and internationally, is pretty great. On the federal level, we're looking at significant investments into a series of bills that have been passed in the past few years, the Inflation Reduction Act, the CHIPS Act, the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act, heavy investment into climate tech and clean energy, as well as at COP, we saw Vice President Harris's announcement of some major, major commitments into the billions of dollars by the U.S. government, both at home and abroad, including payment into the or commitments into the global climate action across the board. So I think there's a lot going on. There's definitely some limitations. And going back to your discussion of the loss and damage fund, earlier this year, while testifying before Congress, one of the rare kind of calm and agreement moments between the panel and Mr. Kerry was where he said very, very strongly that the U.S. would not pay any sort of climate reparations, right? That's the big sentiment. That's the big feeling when it comes into the loss and damage fund. That means things like how it's structured, and we've heard a little bit about that, and I'm sure Bella will have some more insights from her time there. There's a big push by the U.S. and many other governments for this to be a voluntary effort. It's not a reparations system. It's really a contribution by the global north to support the efforts by the global south and to undo some of the damage that's happening there. So I do think in that regard, there is some limitation as far as what that amount of money would look like, because if you start tying it to the magnitude of harm and sort of claiming it as a reparations system, I don't think that would have passed muster here in the US as far as getting that funding approved. And in fact, even the commitments that are being made already now by the US delegations and or delegates, we'll have to see what happens, right? This is ultimately the post-COP time is arguably even more important in many ways, where we see everyone go back to their home countries and figure out if they can actually implement the commitments, right? In our case, can we get the funding approved, right? Can it make its way through Congress to get that funding approved to stand up those commitments?
And I understand that there's a key agreement in the US right now that you're trying to work on to reduce methane emissions. Are you able to tell us a bit more about that? Is that anywhere closer to reaching agreement?
Yeah, so that was a big development. It was announced at COP just this week. And so it's a final rulemaking by the EPA. We'll have to see if there are legal challenges to it. It's a mammoth law. I mean, we're talking about, I think, 1,000+ pages, lots of information. It is a big development in the US. It's the first time that EPA has placed nationwide limits on existing sources in the oil and gas sector. Methane, I think, as we all know, and presumably if you're on this webinar, you're interested and know enough about the role of methane in climate change, but it's a significant contributor to climate change. In the US context, that's a big part of the negotiations on the international stage. So one of the big things John Kerry has been working on is bilateral relations with China related to climate change. We know a lot of that progress has stalled with regards to trade issues, but on climate, we're able to see some progress there and some compromising. Putting it in a very, very summarized version, right? We know the US and a lot of the international community are pushing for China to move away from coal. The flip side of that is there's a lot of pressure for the US to move away from natural gas, right? We've already moved away from coal, but then going to natural gas, which is a major emitter of methane. And so this rule is targeting that. I think it's part of this global compromise and attempt at by the US to make progress towards meeting its reduction targets and to live up to its international commitments. We'll see how the implementation of it goes. I know there are a lot of concerns. Some of them were addressed between the proposed rule stage and now at the final rule. I know many of us in the environmental law field are still digging through the rule and trying to see what the details look like. And like I said at the beginning, there are likely to be some legal challenges. We'll see what that looks like. But if all goes to plan, then we're looking at some 80% reduction in methane emissions over the next 15 years, which would go certainly a long way towards meeting the US's targets.
And the main focus from a financing perspective, we talked quite a bit about, is the loss and damage fund. But another fund to keep an eye on at COP28 is the adaptation fund. It hasn't been so prominent in the media, but it's key to reducing emissions and achieving the targets set out in the Paris Agreement. Graham, are you able to tell us a bit more about adaptation and what this fund is seeking to achieve?
Sure. So the Adaptation Fund came out of the Cancun Adaptation Framework, which was, about 10 years ago. That was my first COP in 2011, 2010. And it's part of a kind of adaptation package. And that's what started the work on loss and damage as well. It's what created the Adaptation Committee. So all of these frameworks are kind of reaching maturity now that they've been around for a decade. And I think it's a bit of a cautionary tale in terms of this loss and damage fund, was that the international community set up the adaptation fund and lots of pledges adaptation. So in the UNFCCC lingo, there's a stark divide between mitigation and adaptation, and it's different than how we even in the environmental law world use those terms. Mitigation is strictly about reducing emissions. Adaptation has nothing to do with reducing emissions and is just about adapting to climate impacts. So the idea of mitigating climate impacts that we talk about all the time in environmental communities doesn't work in the UNFCCC world. It's you're adapting to climate change impacts. So the fund was created, but there has not been the funding allocated to the fund necessary to keep up with what it was created for. So just last month, we got the United Nations Environment Program released their adaptation gap report that was commissioned by a COP. And that was to look at what are the kind of active pipeline projects, what are the adaptation needs of countries around the world, and what is the funding situation look like. And what they found was there are $400 million worth of projects that are in the pipeline ready to go that aren't funded. And so this is adaptation that could start tomorrow that isn't happening because there isn't the funding for it. And also that the needs of adaptation overall globally are about 10 to 18 times higher than what is being funded. So meanwhile, we've got a situation where funding for adaptation in the last 2 years has actually declined by 15%, despite pledges and commitments made by countries. So it's now only the global funding for climate adaptation in 2021 was $21 billion, which is the expected need is about 194 to 366 billion per year. So we're talking big amounts of money, but adaptation is expensive, and this is related to climate finance more generally, because adaptation is expensive, but it is less expensive than loss and damage, and it's more expensive than mitigation. So funding emissions reduction is the cheapest way to address climate change. If you fail to do that, you wind up in adaptation, which is more expensive. And if you fail to do that, you end up with loss and damage, which is even more expensive. So there is a bit of a concern that we're passing the buck on to future funds. All three are needed. We're in a situation where climate change is with us now. So all three are needed, but there's a question of whether we're rising to meet the needs there.
Thanks, Graham. And aside from these funds and the other pledges that are made by governments, the energy industry itself will be a key player to reduce emissions, you know, in order to meet the Paris Agreement targets. And Bella, you went along to day six of COP, and one of the focuses here was the energy industry and the just transition to a sustainable economy. What were the key points from the energy industry?
Well, I think, you know, the real key point that I saw was the need for the 43% reduction from the Paris Agreement. And are we going to be able to achieve 43% reduction in carbon emissions by 2030? At this point, probably not. I think, you know, we also saw the global cooling pledge as well. So there were 63 countries committed to reducing cooling related emissions across all sectors, which is obviously fantastic. And at least 68% by 2050, including taking specific measures to address the energy intensive refrigerants, which I think is quite important. We saw, you know, a lot of talk about trying to make sure that there is a just transition and not just a transition. So I went to a talk, a panel discussion, actually, and one of the panel speakers, a gentleman named Charles Perry, he worked for BP up until the early 2000s and actually set up their kind of like renewable energy initiative. And he was a very, very interesting person to talk to. And he actually said, we need a sustainable revolution. So, you know, we had the industrial revolution of the 19th century, 18th century. Then we had, you know, the electricity revolution and then the technology revolution. And now we need the sustainability, like the sustainable revolution. The issues that I saw arising. I mean, they weren't maybe said explicitly, but for solar panels, for example, you still need to mine lithium. And lithium ore is actually one of the most difficult things to mine. The machinery needed to mine lithium is super carbon intensive. And you're going to countries where, you know, they haven't got a modern slavery act like we do in the UK. And, you know, you've got exploitation of people as well as the world's resources. So, yes, we can move to renewable energy, but we're still going to be extracting the Earth's natural resources. And so I think there also needs to be an awareness of it. And not just kind of this tip of the iceberg view that we can just put loads of wind farms and solar farms and hydro power plants all over the world, and yay, we don't have any oil and gas or natural gas anymore. There's no coal, but you know we're still mining metal, and you know we're still being extractive. You're not creating a circular economy. So I think you know there needs to be a little bit more thought that goes into that as well.
Yeah, and one of the UK government's key parts of their strategies to decarbonize the economy, you know, part of their sustainable revolution, is green hydrogen. You know, it's hailed as a revolutionary alternative to fossil fuels, and the government wants to establish the UK as a world leader in its production. But the technology is still in its infancy, and there's clearly a long way to go. This year, just two small facilities have opened in the UK, which represents just 0.1% of the 5 gigawatts that the government wants up and running by 2030. And Miram and Graham, do you see the same in the US and Canada? Has green hydrogen taken off?
Looks like Graham's giving me the ladies first nod, so I'll go first. Yeah, and I'm sure we'll say some of the similar things, because I know in general, I mean, North America accounts for a large percentage of announced projects worldwide when it comes to green hydrogen. There's some back and forth between kind of where Europe stands and where North America stands as far as the progress goes. And I think to what you were alluding to, Nick, one of the big issues is really the cost associated with it. This is, you know, an emerging technology. There's immense cost prohibitions or kind of considerations related to it being able to really take off as a viable option. And so here in the US, I think we've officially hit critical mass, if you will, when it comes to legislation and policy supporting the role of clean hydrogen or green hydrogen in the US energy transition. So I mentioned earlier the Inflation Reduction Act and a couple of other acts in the US that, you know, collectively have been estimated at something around $500 billion over the next decade towards the clean energy transition. And the Inflation Reduction Act in particular is a strong incentivizer in supporting the green energy transition through its different programs, including manufacturing credits and similar incentive programs that help offset that cost. But to date, it's still very expensive. We haven't fully reached a point where, you know, the cost effectiveness makes sense. I think we're headed towards that. There's, you know, strong efforts to get hydrogen hubs set up strategically across the US and to make it a viable option. So we'll see what unfolds in the next few years. A lot of focus on project development related to that space. And ultimately, the role with these hubs would be to improve the supply, right? If once we get to a point where there's a viable enough supply where the cost can go down and it can just go forward from there. One of the concerns that I've been hearing about, though, related to that is, you know, 10 years seems like a long time, but it can really fly by. And so thinking through, you know, the Inflation Reduction Act, which we're already a year or so in at this point, what happens after the Inflation Reduction Act incentives go away in 2032? So that's something that's being kind of thought about. We've got the funding for now. We hope it will get applied strategically and the industry can move quickly and get to a point where it's sustainable and viable. But the flip side of that is the concern that we don't sort of make it marketable and viable in time. So we'll see. More to come on that. I'm not sure where Canada is, Graham.
Yeah, I mean, I think we're not too far behind. The Canadian economy is dealing with, or Canadian politics is dealing with, is currently kind of mired in kind of some nasty jurisdictional fights on climate between federal and provincial jurisdiction, and hydrogen seems to be, or clean hydrogen seems to be, one of the few areas where all the provinces and the feds are in total lockstep and agreement that this is worthwhile. Now the question is, you know, where's the support for funding and financing projects? That being said, there have been, in the last few years, there have been 6 or 7 big projects, and one was just announced in Quebec that's a $4 billion green hydrogen project that'll be, it's set to produce 70,000 tons a year of green hydrogen. I think where Canada's, and Canada's also set, we have a hydrogen strategy that's set a 30% end use energy target to be coming from clean hydrogen. Most of the target for that is on long haul trucking and long haul transport, because that's a kind of an easy win to transition that whole industry into clean hydrogen use. One of the problems Canada has, and the US probably has as well, is that energy here globally is comparatively cheap. And so it's tough to make the economic case for a very expensive clean energy product. One of the ways that Canada's finding to get around that and to try to build up the infrastructure for clean hydrogen is through trade deals and export deals. So we have one with the Netherlands and one with Germany. And this is particularly relevant for Europe, where energy is much more expensive, and especially in light of Europe's particular interest in getting away from natural gas from the Ukraine, that's opened opportunities for Canadian hydrogen export to become a viable alternative to that fuel source.
Thanks, Graham. And as you alluded to earlier, as part of this year's COP, all nations are required to assess the implementation of the Paris Agreement as part of a global stocktake. And the UN describes the stocktake as a process, countries and stakeholders to see where they're collectively making progress towards meeting the goals of the Paris Agreement and where they're not. And the text of the stocktake is still being negotiated and it will hopefully be agreed towards the end of COP28. And the focus, as is often the case, will be on commitments to phase down or phase out the use of fossil fuels. And there'll be a lot of eyes on how far the signatories will all agree to go on that. I'd just like to end today's webinar by carrying out our own miniature stock take, if you like. So if you're all to rate the international progress towards the goals of the Paris Agreement or where you think we need to go further, how would you say we're doing? Bella, I'll start with you.
What, in a few words, a minute or so?
Yeah, in a nutshell, in a few words.
How long have you got? I think we've got a big road ahead of us. We are obviously heading in the right direction. You know, there's definitely more awareness now. People are talking about it way more than they were 10 years ago, and definitely, you know, more than they were 20 years ago. But even in the last couple of years, I've noticed a huge change. With our projects and infrastructure team here, you can see our credentials documents go slowly from oil and gas and coal plants, all, you know, and now those have been phased out a few years ago. We're only focusing on renewables now, which is obviously an incredible thing. But in terms of the Sustainable Development Goals, the UN 17 Sustainable Development Goals, we've got a long way to go because they're all intersectional. You know, you can't have an improvement in clean water without having an improvement in healthcare. You can't have you can't end poverty without, you know, ending world hunger. And there's a lot of you know, crossing over of the sustainable development goals. And if you just focus on one, which I think a lot of delegates are doing at COP, they're just only focusing on the things that they think are important. You're not going to really get anywhere. You need to look at things holistically, and, you know, have it all under one umbrella and all come together and trust each other, speak to each other, communicate and work together. Hopefully we can get there in time, but let's see.
I think you're right. And you know, from my own perspective, I think on that holistic thinking, and then like you said earlier, you know, we're still going to be using fossil fuels for a very long time. You know, agreements will try and be made to phase down and phase out the use of fossil fuels, but that will take a long time. In the meantime, the technology to reduce emissions, things like carbon capture and storage and green hydrogen is where, you know, a lot of the progress should be made. And, you know, we're seeing a lot of effort from on that side. But Maram, over to you.
Hard comments to follow. No, I think I agree with a lot of Bella's comments. And for me, I think there's something to be said for not letting the perfect get in the way of good, right? Obviously, that gets heavily criticized in this context, where sometimes good is not good enough, right? So we're seeing a lot of that push and pull. But we're seeing, I mean, leaps and bounds, things that just two or three COPs ago were unimaginable, right? I mean, even this conversation about the phase out of oil and gas, right? I know there was the gradual progression from phase down to phase out, and who knows, by the end of this COP, that language may be stripped out. But the fact that it's being entertained, that it's being negotiated, that it's part of the conversation, and at a COP that has, I believe, the highest number of oil and gas industry representatives ever attending it, right? And so the industry is a part of the conversation. This isn't, you know, a pointing the finger or an accusatory, you know, or negative conversation. There is productive progress happening and productive conversations happening, especially as we look at, you know, technology transitions and the evolution of what is possible. You know, one of the big announcements at COP this week was what I believe about 50 oil and gas companies that shared their emissions reductions, you know, voluntary emissions reductions targets, right? The 80 to 90% reductions that they're looking at. So there's a lot of progress happening. I think it's just a matter of keeping that momentum going. And going back to the stock taking consideration of it, keeping and taking stock of the different levels of progress and initiatives that are happening. So when we talk about COP, it's obviously very international focused, right? We're talking very big picture. We get into the details, but it's on the international arena. From a US perspective, we've got a lot going on federally. I know that gets put in the news a lot. There's a lot going on the state and local levels too, right? So there are major initiatives and even across the market, right, across the private sector, there's a lot going on. And so I think those efforts are important to keep track of. Things like California's climate disclosure and greenhouse gas emission bills that were proposed and passed into legislation this year. You know, they're very progressive legislation. New Jersey's got a gas-powered vehicle ban by 2035. So we've got a lot of these different efforts going on. So I think doing that stock taking and seeing where we are as far as progress, obviously the numbers are what they are, and I'll defer to the experts and the scientists as far as, you know, the modeling goes and meeting the 1.5 target. But I think there's a lot to be optimistic about, and we just have to keep pushing in a productive way.
We've had our first question from the audience, and it might be one for you, Graham, to answer as part of your own stock take. Will COP28 be remembered as a classic? Will it be a COP that we look back on as being a game changer?
Sure. Yeah, and I mean, I won't repeat my colleagues' comments, because I think I share their view that, you know, if you're measuring against 1.5 degrees, we're not doing so great. If you're measuring against how much progress we've made in these talks, could I have imagined a conversation about phasing out fossil fuels 10 years ago being in the text? No, I couldn't have imagined that. And so we are making real progress there. And I think in terms of getting to the question we've got, that's a great example of what COP can accomplish. So the idea, I think if this is remembered, it will be remembered for success or failure on the global stock take and for the creation of the loss and damage fund. I don't want my warnings to about my concerns about it, the fund not being sufficiently funded, to downplay how significant it is that on paper there was no loss and damage fund even in conception until just about a year ago. And in 1 year, negotiators came ready on day one of the negotiations to agree to set up and institutionalize the fund. Are there flaws? Are there questions remain? Absolutely, there will be. But that, I think, really demonstrates what the international community can accomplish in a very short amount of time if they're rallying around and working together person to person. These are people who are negotiating. They see each other. They meet each other year round. They know each other very well. They share successes and failures. And then they go back home and they fight their individual fights in their home countries as well. So I really don't want to understate how monumental it is that that was accomplished, and that it shows the potential of these talks pushing things forward in unexpected directions, in unexpected positive directions. So I'm holding out hope that in terms of the final result, that we get somewhere good with the global stock take. But I think already the parties have accomplished something very significant in setting up that fund.
Thanks, Graham. And I think the key word from everyone there is optimism. And there are plenty of things to be optimistic about, despite all the doom and gloom that we read about. Today marks the halfway point of COP28. But Gowling's also running a webinar next Thursday. At the end of COP28, which will be chaired by a partner in the London Environment Team and co-chair of the firm's ESG practice, Ben Stansfield. So please look out for further information on that, or get in touch if you'd like a link to sign up. And that just leaves me to say thank you to all of our panelists today, Maram, Isabella, Graham, and I hope everyone has found this evening's webinar to be worthwhile. If you do have any further questions or would like to talk with any of us, I'm sure we'd all be grateful and happy to talk more. At the end of the webinar, you should receive a feedback form pop up. And if you have the time, please do fill this in, as we'd love to hear your thoughts on our webinar today and any ideas you have for the future. But for now, thank you.